It's been our privilege this year to have Dr. David Sedlacek as our DTS ministry missionary, in residence. He and his wife Kathy are missionaries with TEAM, the Evangelical Alliance Mission. After graduating from DTS in 1994, they went to Japan, where they led a planted crossroad church in the city of Okayama. They later served on church planting teams in Tokyo, in the Prague, Czech Republic. He coaches leaders and teams in cross-cultural ministry as he serves as our missionary in residence. The achievement that brings him the most fulfillment, he says, however, is raising three fine sons. He, along with his wife, Kathy, who's here this morning with him. That's Daniel, who's 19, Timothy, who's 21, and Andrew, who's 24. David, thank you for your ministry among us this year, Kathy as well. Would you join me in thanking him as he comes?
Well, I knew I'd be extremely nervous to come to do this today. I was kind of delighted to realize as I'm sitting there a few minutes before that I am not as nervous now as I was in that first preaching class in 1989. Or a couple years later when I, for some reason, took a second preaching, an elective, I didn't even have to take because I was going to be a missionary, but I took a class with Dr. Warren and Dr. Bach, and that was much worse than tension than I feel like right now. So. I'm thankful for that experience. I am a missionary in residence. My wife and I are missionaries in residence, and the question that I get consistently all year long, all school year, has been, what does a missionary in residence do? Or a variation on that, what exactly is a missionary in residence? Now, I'm not going to answer that question today, sorry. But I want to reflect on, what I reflect on is, why do I keep hearing this question? Why is that the first question that comes up? And I think it's because people inherently know something about missionaries. Missionaries don't belong here. Missionaries are those who go away to places where Jesus is unknown. So why is there a missionary in residence at Dallas Theological Seminary? Now, if you ask a missionary in residence, as Pastor Joe did, to speak at chapel, don't be surprised if he asks you to take some time to look at the Great Commission together. So that's what we're going to look at, Matthew 28 specifically. I want to challenge your imagination today. The challenge is to dream a bigger dream. J.B. Phillips wrote a book in the 1950s, the title, Your God is Too Small, and that's true. Completely true. Our God is too small. And I also want to say today that your world is too small. Now, one of my sons, Dr. Bailey already mentioned my pride in my three great sons, and our middle son is a real theater and acting drama. He loves doing it, and he loves studying movies, and he lets us know every year all the good movies that are coming out. And this summer, he let us know that La La Land was one of the big movies coming out this fall, and we better get ready for it. It's going to be great. It's a musical. It's got just everything the picture needs to have. And sure enough, it received all kinds of awards and nominations this season. The Academy Awards had 14 nominations, the most since any film since the Titanic, the same as Titanic had 20 years ago. And they came away with 6 awards. They almost got the best picture. If you saw the awards ceremony, you know that story. Came really close to that. And I keep wondering if I'm about to get taken off stage here too, like are you really asking me to do this? But it's a great, we got to watch it over the Christmas break with a couple of our sons and one of our son's fiancés. It was great, fun to watch. And indeed the music, it's a musical, and that's one of the great things about it is the music. It's a story about the dreams of two people, an aspiring actress who dreams of making her big break and show business, and then a jazz musician whose dream is to run his own club so that he can save jazz from extinction. And their dreams inform the choices they make throughout the movie. In the eyes of those who are watching it, some of those actions that they take based on their dreams seem rather foolish. Two of the songs from La La Land were nominated for Best Song. One of them was The Fools Who Dream. It's a story about Mia, the actress, is her aunt who lived in Paris. And she loved life. She did a lot of crazy things, and she was a dreamer. And as she was walking along the Seine River one day, she leapt for joy, and she smiled, she leapt, and she ended up tumbling into the Seine River. The water was freezing. She spent a month sneezing, but she said she would do it again. That's how the song goes. Mia, the actress, draws inspiration from this aunt who's willing to do crazy, stupid things for the sake of a dream. Even though, or perhaps because of the mistakes that they make, the fools who dream give us new colors to see. The chorus goes like this: here's to the ones who dream, foolish as they may seem. Here's to the hearts that ache. Here's to the mess we make. And they make a lot of messes along the way. I'm a missionary. Sometimes I feel like I'm a fool who dreams, doing some pretty crazy things, taking my family along and doing some pretty crazy things, making some messes along the way, and all the while knowing I would do it again. I wouldn't change the story that the Lord has given us to lead. It's been sort of like a dream come true to be back here at Dallas Theological Seminary. I really do have to pinch myself every once in a while. It is just a great blessing and privilege to be here, to live in Swiss Tower, one block away from where Kathy and I spent our two first years of marriage, to get reacquainted and see in a different, from a different angle, some of the faculty that were here when I was a student. An opportunity to thank some of them who probably don't even remember me, but because they made a great impact on my life and my ministry. And then to walk around the campus and walk into the halls of Campbell and Todd and Walvard. One of the surprising things that every time it hits me when I come back to this campus is Todd and Walvard, they smell exactly the same. They both smell different, but they smell the way they did 25 years ago. Then the first day of chapel last semester when I was introduced as a missionary here and as Dr. David Sedlacek. I've only had the PhD a couple of years, so I still feel really uncomfortable when I hear that attached to my name. It's not part of my lifelong identity, but it was really, really, really wow, I just got introduced here at the seminary. What a privilege, even to teach a course here this spring. So it feels like a dream come true. It's just like amazing. But then I remind myself that this isn't my dream. I didn't come to Dallas Theological Seminary in August 1989 in order to become missionary in residence at Dallas in 2017. I came to DTS with a different dream. Like Mia and Sebastian in La La Land, sometimes I do need to remind myself of what my dream is and stay on track. The dream that dropped me to DTS, it began about a year before. It really began when I was born, but we won't go that far back. But I was 21 years old. I was single. I had met the woman that would become my wife, but she didn't know that yet. In fact, she wasn't even interested in dating. But she was really interested in one thing I was interested in, which was talking about the world and talking about what God was doing in the world. And we had a friend, a young Dallas grad, who challenged us, what is God doing in the world? He challenged us to think about that question. And that's what we did. We did his challenge. We read the Bible with that question in mind. What is God up to among the nations? Gary challenged us to read the news, not just about what was going on in this country, but read the news about what's going around the world. He challenged us to get to know missionaries, reading biographies of some of the missionaries of days gone by, and writing letters. This is just before email, so we actually did write letters to missionaries to get to know them and to learn how to pray for them and to pray for the peoples of the world. And most of all, though, to search the scriptures and ask, what is God up to in the world? God showed me that he has a plan for the nations and he has a place for me in it. And that's the dream that brought me to Dallas. I believe God had a place for me in his plan for the nations, and I came to DTS here to prepare to go somewhere else. The dream is founded in scriptures like Genesis 12, 1 through 3. The Lord had said to Abram, leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all peoples on the earth will be blessed through you. I discovered this theme that runs throughout the Old Testament, that God wasn't just interested in blessing one people as much as he was and as much as he chose those people as his, but through those people he intended to bless all the peoples of the earth. And that runs throughout scripture. I'm just on my way today. Kathy noted I'm very low tech this morning. I'm not using my iPad as my outline or anything, and I'm using my Bible that I usually read from here, which is what I was planning. I was going to be very low tech. But then on the way in, I glanced up at the scriptures, and they're all over campus, right? How many of you actually look at these every once in a while, the banners that are up there? And, well, I did. Just on the way in, I just looked up, and lo and behold, there was a scripture, so I took a picture of it. Exodus 9:16. But I have raised you up for this very purpose, that I might show you my power, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. God didn't choose Moses simply to deliver his people, but in order that his name might be proclaimed in all the earth. And that runs throughout scripture. The Psalms are full of it, such as Psalm 96. First few verses of that. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise his name, proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. God has this plan for the nations, and he's been working it out as long as he's been working out his entire plan. It wasn't enough that one nation on earth would enter into a covenant relationship with him. God's intention was to be praised among all nations. Habakkuk 2:14 is one of my favorite verses, has been since that time before I came to seminary, when I discovered Habakkuk 2:14, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, just like the waters cover the sea. Now, the waters cover the sea like completely, thoroughly, right? That's what the sea's all about, is the waters. And that's where we're headed. That's the earth that will be filled with the knowledge of his glory. And we see that all the way in into the New Testament. In Revelation, it gives us that picture. In Revelation 7, after this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. They were wearing white robes, holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb. When they say salvation belongs to our God, this wasn't a bunch of Americans saying salvation belongs to the American God, nor was it salvation belongs to the African God or the Latin God or any particular nation. It was all of the nations were together. Our God is the God of all of us. And then, of course, the Great Commission, which comes in several places. Today I want to look at Matthew 28, where Jesus says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, therefore go and make disciples of all nations. So it was that year that I became thoroughly convinced and knew, I saw that God had a plan for the nations and he had a place for me in it. I didn't know exactly what my place was, and I'm still always figuring that out. I've learned after 25 years since then, and still keep singing the same song as we sang this morning together, to ask the Lord to show us where to go next, where to go now. But I knew at that time I wanted to be involved in proclaiming the gospel where the gospel wasn't being proclaimed. I wanted to make disciples where there are a few other disciple makers. And I learned by studying about the world that there's a lot of places in the world like that. A lot of places that fit that description. We're here in this corner of the world where there are lots and lots of churches compared to wide swaths of Asia where there are none. 30% of Americans are evangelical believers. In Europe, less than 1% in most of Europe. At least 4 billion people are still unreached with the good news of Jesus. The other day, Dr. Bailey shared that 95% of pastors never receive formal training. And since I'm part of the 5%, in fact, I believe even in a smaller percentage than that, I'm one of those who've received some of the best ministry training that I could possibly have, both through Dallas Seminary, through the churches in North Texas that I grew up in. I want to be a blessing to the 95%, most of whom don't live in the United States of America. 97% of full-time American Christian workers stay in America. So Kathy and I decided, well, we want to be part of that 3%. We're going to go somewhere else. I say we because at the end of that year, Kathy and I had both moved from being willing to go to planning to go. And we had both enrolled at DTS, and we decided to go for it together. So we came here as newlyweds. I was now 22 years old, married, had a partner. I was studying Greek and Trinitarianism and hermeneutics at Dallas Theological Seminary with a dream to go somewhere that people didn't have an opportunity to hear the gospel, to make Christ known in a place where Christ wasn't known. While here, God gave us a vision to become church planters and to go to Japan. So that's what we did. We raised three beautiful sons in Japan. We proclaimed the gospel to Japanese who had never heard who Jesus was. We baptized people who placed their faith in Christ. We taught young believers. We saw churches planted and we saw disciples multiplied. Before I go any further, I'd like to clarify something, that my story is not your story, my calling is not your calling, and I'm not actually saying that the Great Commission means that every single one in this room is supposed to go to some other culture and live among the people of another culture and make disciples among people of another culture. But I do think that each one of us in this room should take time, would profit from a fresh look at the Great Commission, at these words of Jesus, and take an intentional but sincere moment to ask, God, would you have me go? And if I'm not to go, what am I to do within your plan for the nations? What am I to do to help your church to go? So if we could look at Matthew 28, 16 to 20, a little more closely. This isn't when the plan began, but it is when Jesus invited us to join in his plan. I'm not going to give a full exposition of this morning, but I want to offer a few reminders and reflections that I think all of us need to hear more than we hear. Matthew 28, 16, Jesus says, well, first Matthew lays the context. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. I'm so glad, the longer I serve Christ, the more I appreciate these words, these three little words, and some doubted. I used to think that God uses the wise, the skillful, the very best to change the world, but the longer I've served in Christ's church around the world, the more I realize that he calls imperfect servants, even those of us whose faith is weak, to make Christ known to the nations. The longer I've served in the global mission enterprise, the more I realize that I'm not so perfect myself, and I'm glad he calls me even so. But the focus of Matthew here is not upon our doubt. It is on the authority and presence of Jesus. So let's keep reading verse 18. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age." I'd like to make four observations. First, Jesus says, because all authority is given to me, go. David Turner summarizes it this way, mission is possible because Jesus is potent. I think we should add, mission is non-negotiable because Jesus is potentate. It's not only that he has power to command, but he has the right to command. He has authority. the Great Commission is great because it's the commission given us by the Lord of heaven and earth. Second, just note this word go. Jesus really does mean go. It's confusing because although our Bibles consistently translate this go and make disciples, we often hear Bible teachers, others say, well, it's a participle in the original language. And that's true, but there's a reason that our Bibles translate this as a verb, main verb, go. Because it doesn't mean as you go or when you go or if you go. It has imperativa force just like the main verb that it's connected with. I learned that here, by the way, when I was a Greek student. And I reaffirmed it by going to check Dr. Wallace's grammar book, the participle of attendant circumstance. In constructions like this, which are all over the New Testament, the emphasis is on the main verb, which in this case is make disciples. In other words, it's not the going, it's the disciple making that matters, that really counts. But that first verb in these constructions, it's a prerequisite to the second. It's not an option. In other words, we have to go in order to make disciples. You can't do the second without the first. Just a few verses ahead, above that, in verse 7, the angel speaking to the two Marys at the empty tomb, and he says, go and tell his disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. It's the same, it's a participle, go. And the idea is, yes, the important thing is tell the disciples. They need to know that Jesus is no longer dead. They need to know that. But they're not going to find out unless you guys go, you two ladies go and tell. In Acts 16:9, Paul is in Troas, and the Macedonian man calls in a vision, come and help us. It's the same construction. It's a participle, come. And the Macedonian really wants help, so he's saying, help us, but you're not going to be able to help us unless you come. You need to get in that boat and come to our neck of the woods. So the body of Christ is to go. The 11 disciples couldn't begin making disciples of all nations until they began going to all nations. And neither can we. The church is to go to the nations. And whether that means you or the person sitting next to you, I don't know. But I do know that we, his body, have a role to play in the going to the nations. Jesus says, go and make disciples of all nations. Frederick Bruner's comment on this I love. He says, Jesus' all nations gives disciples a world vision. It creates longings to see a universal spread of the mission, a worldwide renewal of the churches, and an international conversion of the peoples. Christians are now hopelessly, incurably missionary and evangelistic. I already told you that I don't think Jesus' Great Commission is telling every Christian is commanded to go spend his life as a missionary to the unreached. But I do think, as I said before, that each of us who are disciples of this Jesus profit from a fresh look at these words of Jesus and ask intentionally, sincerely, God, would you have me go? And if I'm not to go, what am I to do? What is my role in your plan for the nations? I heard this story many times when I was here in the past that Dr. Chafer prayed that there would be a year when the entire class of the seminary would deploy as missionaries. And I'd love to see that prayer realized. I think it'd be great if the class of 2017 or the class of 2018 or 2019, 2020, if you deployed a part of the world that needs Christian leaders and witnesses and disciple makers and teachers, church planters and helpers and counselors and technical people, more than the church needs them here in Dallas, Texas. The fulfillment of the Great Commission, however, doesn't depend on doing that. We don't have to. Every single one of us don't need to physically go necessarily. But I do think a lot more of us should be going to some of the hard places, to some of the unreached places, to some of the gospel has never been preached before places of the world. Our alumni map, DTS's website, alumni map, it shows you where all the different alumni are. I don't know if it's 100% of all the alumni, but the ones they have. And about 1 in 10 of those live outside of the U.S. And I was really impressed by that, that that's a high percentage. I realized that actually most of those DTS alumni who don't live in the U.S. are international alumni. In other words, students that came from overseas and they studied here and they went back to their home countries. And that's a wonderful way that Dallas Seminary blesses the nations by training people from all nations that come here and sending them back out. But I do want to say, I think that we Americans who are from here, we Texans who are from Texas and very proud of it, we Dallasites who grew up here in this city, more of us could go to places that are not very much like Dallas, Texas. Finally, in Matthew 28, verse, the end of the Great Commission, Jesus notes, "I am surely, and surely, I am with you always to the end of the age." Just as his authority is the foundation of the commission, his presence is our assurance that we have nothing to fear. And I'm glad, because when you're on mission, you run into frightful circumstances. La La Land, as time goes on in the story, the two protagonists lose sight of their dreams, and they go through this tension, and they have to refocus in order to keep going. And there's another great song in the movie. Actually occurs earlier in the movie, but it portrays this tension. And it's actually the song that won Best Song for the Academy Awards this year. The City of Stars is described as hopeful yet melancholic. And this song, it starts out, "City of Stars, are you shining just for me? City of Stars, there's so much that I can't see. Who knows? Is this the start of something wonderful and new? Or just one more dream that I can't make true?" And I relate to that, because in my 25 years as a missionary, and I've experienced many times when I ask myself, I don't think I can do this. This is hard. It was hard to take my children, at that time a 3-month-old and 2-year-old, away from my parents and to raise them away from my family and the places that were precious to me. That's actually been the single toughest thing about my whole missions career. It was hard to learn a language. It's so tough that no matter how long you study it, you're never going to speak like a native speaker. You're always going to be an outsider. And then when you come back to your home and you realize that you've become an outsider here too, when you come home, you don't really feel at home anymore. Then dealing with conflict with colleagues, difficult. We spent 11 years in one city, one small church was born, one little pebble in a big ocean of a dream. I can count on my two hands the number of people that I personally led to Jesus Christ in Japan. Not that I only talked about Jesus a little bit, talked about him a lot. I can count on one hand the number of people I baptized in Japan. But there is a beautiful church in the city of Okayama today. It's almost a decade since we left, and it's still led by the Japanese pastor and the wife that Kathy and I mentored and worked with for 6 years. And it's doing well. And for 10,000 years, people in that community had never had a church until the year 1997. There would never been a church for 10,000 years of people living there. And there's a church there today. So that's pretty special. I'm glad God gave us that dream. I'm glad God invited Kathy and Timothy and Andrew and Daniel and myself to be a part, to spend those 11 years we did in Okayama and the other places we've gone to help start churches. You've all faced discouragements too. You came here with dreams, turned out to be tougher than you thought or tougher in different ways than you expected it to be. Maybe your grades aren't what they were in college. Maybe your job prospects aren't what you thought they would be when you started seminary. Maybe you're not even sure you're headed in the right direction that God would have you go. It's a good time to check back in with Matthew 28. Because this is a dream not just for me, but it's a dream for the faculty and the staff and the students of Dallas Theological Seminary. God has a plan for the nations, and we, the body of Christ, have a place in it. I'm asking you to ask the Lord, what would God have me do? Would he have me go? I want you to know that as missionary in residence at Dallas, I'm asking the same questions even this year. Exactly 6 years ago today, Kathy and I decided after much prayer that we would move back to the United States. And we moved with our family. We had lived in Tokyo at the time. 11 days after that decision, the earth shook, literally. The big earthquake came. It was really, really big. And the tsunami came, and the nuclear meltdown came, and our world was turned upside down. And I was already in Japan, already knew where I was, but God then asked me to go and be involved in leading the relief work. And for several weeks, I did that, to the disaster relief work. And it was the hardest few weeks of my working life, just the blew me away how difficult it was. But it was also a time I knew with utter clarity, this is exactly what God was calling me to do in that moment. How he had prepared me for that. Soon after we left Japan, we moved to Virginia. Not because I didn't have a role to play in God's plan for the nations, but because my role had changed. And now is now helping missionaries and missionary teams to succeed in other parts of the world, in Asia, Africa, Europe. 3 years later, we moved to Prague, and we helped start a new church just there. Now I'm in Dallas, Texas, and we love it here. And we're asking the Lord, well, what is next? Do you want us to stay here for a while longer? Do you want us to go again? We're not sure. God has a plan for the nations, and you have a place in it. I want to end up by noting I got to choose today as a day, knowing WEC was coming up. And next week is the World Evangelization Conference. A lot of students look forward to this because this week they get to plan to go serve Christ in some faraway place, and they know that there's people from all over the world that are going to be here, and they get to talk to them and learn about what ministry might be like in that. And it's going to be a great time. Representatives from 35 different mission organizations are here, both that work in the U.S. and Texas among people of other cultures, as well as people all over in some of the hardest reached places in the world. Some of you are looking forward to WEC because there's no classes, and that'll be great too. But counseling students, you're invited to the counseling luncheon on Thursday to find out how much missionaries need counselors, and we do. And there's all kinds of food events, International Food Festival and desserts, and please look at this and figure out where you're going to be and how you're going to do that. William Carey said, to know the will of God, we need an open Bible and an open map. And all through the year, we get to spend a lot of time with an open Bible here. Next week is a time we get to have an open map and look at the open map. So please look and listen. Ask God, should I go? Would you have me go? And if not, what do you want me to do to advance your gospel among the nations?